everybody. Good morning. Beautiful day, huh? Good to be in the house of the Lord. Nice to be here with you. Let me cover just a few announcements quickly as we begin. I want to just remind you of the weekly prayer meetings that do take place here each Monday night. We meet down at the Fellowship Hall, 6 p.m. And we make up a prayer bulletin and we go down through it together. And if you have prayer concerns on your heart, just call them in to me to the church office or just reach out to me. You can text me or email me. We'll get those into the prayer bulletin. We will be 6 p.m. tomorrow night. Tuesday night, 6 p.m. is choir practice. The choir is rehearsing once again. So if you are a choir person or would like to be one, we would love to have you. 6 p.m. is choir rehearsal. 7 o'clock to 8:15 is our Bible study. We meet again in the fellowship hall downstairs. We're doing a study on the end times. I have more books available. If you'd like to jump in there with us, you can jump in now. It would be fine. We would love to have you. Quick reminder that the Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes are up and running, and they need to be returned by November the 15th. And so you can still get boxes if you check in with Reed Equipment or Gretchen. They will get you hooked up. We would love to see a nice outpouring for Operation Christmas Child this year. I had a nice letter in the mail this week from Esther Matthewson, who has now moved into her home, and she wrote a beautiful letter. I took it and posted it downstairs on the bulletin board, so if you want to see a word from Esther, it's there. And then just a couple more things. Our Harvest Supper is coming up Saturday night, this Saturday, 3:30 to 7:30 p.m. It's drive-through only. And Denise asked me to share this information. We are still looking for volunteers to roast turkeys. The turkeys will be at the church tomorrow, all right? Bakers we need for apple crisp and volunteers to help with preparation on Friday and then help on Saturday with cooking, packaging, serving, and cleanup. So there is a sign-up sheet downstairs. We really do need your help. It's going to be a major undertaking. We're anticipating about 700 will come through the line for dinners. So it's going to be huge, and we really do need your help. So thank you in advance for helping us out with that. And then just a couple other quick reminders. Next Sunday afternoon at 1 p.m. for those who are on the church council is our church conference meeting. And so that's at 1 o'clock. We'll meet downstairs in the fellowship hall and throw the thing up on the screen through Zoom so we can all be part of that together. Just a quick shout out, there is a church directory. If your name and your information is not in the church directory, we want to encourage you to do that. You can contact Jeremy Gavin. The information is in your bulletins. Is everybody on the email list? Everybody getting the bulletins? Hello, put your hand up if you're getting the bulletins. Okay, anybody not getting the bulletins that would like to? Okay, give us your information. We'll make sure you get it. Thank you. And then one quick reminder that on November the 29th, that is our last fifth Sunday of the year, November 29th, we will be receiving those who want to join the church as members. And so if you're interested in membership or if you've never been baptized and would like to be baptized, we will do that on November 29th. I simply ask you to let me know. You need to let me know so that we can meet with you and make sure that everything's in place. All right? Are there any other announcements that need to be made? All right. Thank you. And I want to welcome our young people here. We're so glad to have you here with us. God bless you. And we're going to take some time right now to worship the Lord. Let's stand and sing together, please.
Thank you. You have been so kind to me. Thank you.
Step up when you need to. Amen. I want to tell you about my day off this week before we get started. Heidi and I took a trip up to Destiny Mall. Anybody ever been to Destiny Mall? Okay, Destiny Mall people out there. Amen. So we went up to the Destiny Mall. It was our destiny. And we had a nice visit up there. And let me just say that I went into Dick's Sporting Goods because that's where I like to shop. And I even went to some lady's place where she likes to shop. That's okay. So I'm in Dick's Sporting Goods and I'm looking at golf balls, of all things, and this guy comes over, very helpful. He said, "Hi, my name is Ernie." He said, "Can I help you out with any golf balls?" And I said, "Well, I'm just kind of looking around." He says, "You want the low compression balls for this time of year? They fly better in the cold weather." I said, "Oh, thank you. I didn't know that. Thank you for that." So he's pointing out several things and he walks away. And so next thing I know, I'm sitting there, all of a sudden I hear the name of Jesus being spoken, and I'm looking, and up on the TV screen, there's an interview with Bernard Langer. How many are familiar with the golfer, Bernard Langer? Okay, a couple of golf fans out there. And he's sharing his testimony of how he was born again by the Spirit of God, how he met Jesus and it changed his life. And I walk up onto the screen, I'm just enjoying this moment. All of a sudden, this same gentleman comes back over. He says, "It's great, isn't it?" I said, "Yes, it is." And we started the conversation. And I learned a little bit about Ernie, where he met the Lord. He had been living in South Carolina. And met his wife down there, and they both them from up here. They just moved back to the Syracuse area. He said, "I'm looking for a church." And I said, "Well, I'm a pastor. I'd love to have you come to our church." But I said, "You probably need something closer." So I pointed him toward a church there in Syracuse. And I said, "Ernie, could I pray for you?" And he said, "I'd love that." So the two of us, Dick's Sporting Goods, people knowing our, we just took a minute. We just had a little prayer meeting in the middle of Dick's. It was just a beautiful moment. What a blessing. And so then I met Heidi, and we stopped for a soda. You know, we shop for a couple hours, get a soda, then go a couple more, you know, that kind of thing. So we stopped to drink our soda, and as we're getting up, this young lady comes on, this beautiful young African-American lady, and she's cleaning up, and she says, "You folks have a lovely day." And I said, "Well, thank you so much." And I said, "You have a lovely day, and God bless you." She said, "You beat me to it." I was going to say, "God bless you." I said, "Well, let's talk about it." And so we ended up with a nice conversation. And Heidi said to her, she said, "I knew you were a Jesus girl. You're a Jesus girl, aren't you?" She says, "You bet you I'm a Jesus girl. Every morning, every night, I'm in prayer and praying for you know." So we just had a beautiful little prayer meeting there in the middle of the food court, Destiny Mall, with a lady. She said, "I just go by the initial CT. That's my name." So Heidi said, "Let me pray for you." So we had a little prayer meeting there with CT in the food court. Listen, your faith is a living thing, and everywhere you go, Jesus is touching people and is happening, and it's okay to talk about Jesus. It is okay to do that. And it's some of the best conversations you'll ever have. So I just wanted to give you that word of encouragement. Christians are everywhere. God has his network out there, and it's fun. When you see this funny smile on someone's face, chances are they just may be a Christian. It just could be. All right, we're going to jump into today's text. We are studying lessons, standing firm in the faith. We've been preaching through the book of Esther. Today we're going to wrap up our study of the book of Esther, chapters 9 and 10. Now, before you get too panicked, chapter 10 is only 3 verses. It's just kind of a little addendum on the chapter 9, so don't think you'll be here for 2 hours. I'll only keep you here an hour and a half, honestly. Okay, so let's jump into it. We're in Esther chapter 9, beginning with verse 1. So on March the 7th, the two decrees of the king were put into effect. On that day, the enemies of the Jews had hoped to overpower them, but quite the opposite happened. It was the Jews who overpowered their enemies. The Jews gathered in their cities throughout all the king's provinces to attack anyone who tried to harm them. But no one could make a stand against them, for everyone was afraid of them. And all the nobles of the provinces, the highest officers, the governors, and the royal officials helped the Jews for fear of Mordecai. For Mordecai had been promoted in the king's palace, and his fame spread throughout all the provinces as he became more and more powerful. So the Jews went ahead on the appointed day and struck down their enemies with the sword. They killed and annihilated their enemies and did as they pleased with those who hated them. In the fortress of Susa itself, the Jews killed 500 men. They also killed Parshandatha, Dalphon, Aspatha, Haratha, Adalia, Aradatha, Parmashta, Arasai, Aradai, and Lizatha, the 10 sons of Haman, the son of Hamadatha, the enemy of the Jews. But they did not take any plunder. That very day, when the king was informed of the number of people killed in the fortress of Susa, he called for Queen Esther. He said, "The Jews have killed 500 men in the fortress of Susa alone, as well as Haman's 10 sons. If they have done that here, what has happened in the rest of the provinces? But now, what more do you want? It will be granted to you. Tell me, and I will do it." Esther responded, "If it please the king, give the Jews in Susa permission to do again tomorrow as they have done today, and let the bodies of Haman's 10 sons be impaled on a pole or hanged on a gallows," depending which translation you read. So the king agreed, and the decree was announced in Susa, and they impaled the bodies of Haman's 10 sons, or hanged them on a gallows. And then the Jews at Susa gathered together on March 8th and killed 300 more men, and again they took no plunder. Meanwhile, the other Jews throughout the king's provinces had gathered together to defend their lives. They gained relief from all their enemies, killing 75,000 of those who hated them, but they did not take any plunder. This was done throughout the provinces on March 7th, and on March 8th they rested, celebrating their victory with a day of feasting and gladness. The Jews at Susa killed their enemies on March 7th and again on March 8th, and then rested on March 9th, making that their day of feasting and gladness. So to this day, rural Jews living in remote villages celebrate an annual festival and holiday on the appointed day in late winter, and they rejoice and send gifts of food to each other. Mordecai recorded these events and sent letters to the Jews near and far throughout all the provinces of King Xerxes, calling on them to celebrate an annual festival on these 2 days. He told them to celebrate these days with feasting and gladness, and by giving gifts of food to each other and presents to the poor. This would commemorate a time when the Jews gained relief from their enemies, when their sorrow was turned into gladness and their mourning into joy. So the Jews accepted Mordecai's proposal and adopted this annual custom. Haman, son of Hamadatha, the Agagite, the enemy of the Jews, had plotted to crush and destroy them on the day determined by casting lots. The lots were called Purim. But when Esther came before the king, he issued a decree, causing Haman's evil plot to backfire, and Haman and his sons were then impaled on a sharpened pole or hanged on the gallows. That is why this celebration is called Purim, because it is the ancient word for casting lots. So because of Mordecai's letter and because of what they had experienced, the Jews throughout the realm agreed to inaugurate this tradition and to pass it on to their descendants and to all who became Jews. They declared they would never fail to celebrate these 2 prescribed days at the appointed time each year. These days would be remembered and kept from generation to generation and celebrated by every family throughout the provinces and the cities of the empire. This festival of Purim would never cease to be celebrated among the Jews, nor would the memory of what happened ever die out among their descendants. Then Queen Esther, the daughter of Abihail, along with Mordecai the Jew, wrote another letter, putting the queen's full authority behind Mordecai's letter to establish the festival of Purim. Letters wishing peace and security were sent to the Jews throughout the 127 provinces of the empire of Xerxes. These letters established the festival of Purim, an annual celebration of these days at the appointed time, decreed by both Mordecai the Jew and Queen Esther. The people decided to observe this festival just as they had decided for themselves and their descendants to establish the times of fasting and mourning. So the command of Esther confirmed the practices of Purim, and it was all written down in the records. King Xerxes imposed a tribute throughout his empire, even to the distant coastlands. His great achievements and the full account of the greatness of Mordecai, whom the king had promoted, are recorded in the book of the history of the kings of Media and Persia. Mordecai the Jew became the prime minister with authority next to that of King Xerxes himself. He was very great among the Jews, who held him in high esteem, because he continued to work for the good of his people and to speak up for the welfare of all their descendants. And may God bless this word to our hearing this morning. Well, when we last left Esther, you will remember that she once again had approached the throne room of the king. Now that Haman was gone, she approached again. And she did so having been assured of her place at his side and knowing that Haman had been removed. Well, once again, the king held out the golden scepter, and as Esther approached, she asked the king to revoke the previous order of Haman, which called for the destruction of the Jewish people. Now, you might remember that a law written according to the dictates of the Medes and Persians cannot be revoked. Therefore, the king was quite unable to alter the decree enacted by the now deceased Haman. The king, however, did understand the dilemma into which he had inadvertently placed Esther, Mordecai, and the Jewish people. So he then gave permission to Mordecai to write another law in contrast to the previous one. He also gave his signet ring to Mordecai and promoted him to prime minister. And so with this new authority, Mordecai went about gathering all the secretaries together and issued a new decree which would allow the Jews to defend themselves against any who would attack them. It was written in every language of the empire and sent out by immediate dispatch. That brings us now today to the final two chapters of the book of Esther, which we will cover. And I want to break today's message down into three parts that will help to give it a structure. The first part is this. Notice in the first 16 verses of chapter 9, notice the fear of the Jews. The fear of the Jews. So the events play out on the appointed day. The New Living Translation gives us the text the date of it was March the 7th of that year. The Hebrew text tells us it was the 13th day of Adar, which is the 12th month on the Hebrew calendar. And so on that day, where the Jews should have been killed, slaughtered, and annihilated, we find that quite the opposite thing happens. Rather, it is the Jews who are able to defend themselves against their enemies, and they annihilate them, although they take none of the plunder for themselves. In fact, the text tells us no one could make a stand against them, for everyone was afraid of them. God sent a fear into the hearts of the Persians that would prevent them from fighting against his people. Now, church, I want to tell you this is a recurring theme in the biblical text. We see it play out as the Jews entered into the promised land. In Deuteronomy 2:25, the Lord says this to Israel. He said, "Beginning today, I will make people throughout the earth terrified of you. When they hear reports about you, they will tremble with dread and fear." And in Genesis 35, as Jacob traveled with his entourage, we read these words, "As they set out, a terror from God spread over the people in all the towns of that area, so no one attacked Jacob's family." And one third mention is when the spies, you remember the spies that entered into Jericho, they met up with the home of Rahab the harlot. Remember that story? She hid the two spies. And afterwards she said this to them. She said, "Our people here are terrified. They have seen how your God fights for you, and they do not want to raise a hand against you guys." And so let me just say this morning, it's a good thing when God fights for his people and when he subdues their enemies before them. Amen? Amen. When you're standing for righteousness, it's a good thing. And so with the people paralyzed with fear, the Israelites were well able to defend themselves against the attacks of their enemies. Now, these people attacked, some of the ones who were the bold ones, they attacked anyway. But notice that in retaliation, the Israelis killed only the heads of the families, the fathers. They did no harm to the women or children. They took none of the plunder, which they had every right to do, but they didn't. They did not want to leave these families with no relief in their losses. And so God honored his people for their restraint. And as a result, the Jews enjoyed a great victory and vindication from their enemies. How many know that God has already gone ahead of you and subdued your enemies before you? He only calls you to walk in faithfulness and stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Amen? Now in the city of Shushan, the capital city itself, we are told that 500 men were killed on that first day, and many more, of course, throughout the provinces of Persia. But now I want you to pick up on this. There's a reversal here on the part of King Xerxes. Up until now, Esther has been the one approaching and summoning the king to action. But notice in verse 12, it is King Xerxes now who calls Esther to report what has been done. He's sending for her and he says, I want you to see what we're doing now to protect you and your people. We see again that God is favoring Esther and Mordecai and all the Jewish people, and that the king is realizing where his bread is buttered. Amen? If it goes well for the Jews, it's going to go well for me. It's going to go well for my kingdom. I'm taking care of these people. God's hand is on these people. I want them taken care of. Amen? And any nation that will take care of God's people first is going to be blessed of the Lord. Blessed is the people whose God is the Lord, the Bible says. So Esther then responds to the king's summons. And when asked, she says, I would ask, Your Highness, that one more day of the Jews defending themselves be allowed here in the capital city. She knew that in the capital city where Haman lived, where his 10 sons were, and where he had incited many people, she knew there were still many enemies out there in the capital city. And so she asked for one more day for the Jews to defend themselves. And she further requested that Haman's 10 sons be impaled on a pole or hung on a gallows. And so I want to talk about that for just a minute. I want to camp out in this thing about Haman's 10 sons being hung on a gallows. Now, it's interesting, and I looked this up. I have an interlinear Bible in my office, and when the 10 sons of Haman are listed, it's very interesting the way it's laid out. But let me just say, one of the teachings of Judaism is that not only are all of the words of the biblical text inspired by God, but also the way the words are spelled and even the way they are arranged on the page is all inspired by God. Did you get that? We're not just saying the word is infallible. It is. But we're saying that even the way words are spelled and even the way the words are put on the page is being inspired by God. Now you say, Pastor, why in the world would that matter? Well, because there are teachings where God spells words differently, and he does it for a reason. And then there are times when the words are arranged on a page in a certain way. By the way, in this text, the words of Haman's 10 sons, where you have the block letters, let's say this is your page, and the page is filled with letters, in the center there's this big space, and up the side is the name of Haman's 10 sons in a long line, and it comes across, and it almost looks like a gallows. God has inspired the way it was written. And so the way it was written is showing you, the rabbis concluded, they said, the way that God has dictated this, it makes these 10 sons, it looks like it could fall over any minute. And these sons are very unstable, just like their father was unstable. And just as their father Haman fell, these 10 men are going to fall as well. And so it looks like a gallows when you're reading the vertical names in the Hebrew text. And there's another thing that's fascinating about the Hebrew text where it mentions the 10 sons of Haman. There are 3 random letters that are in the text that really don't make any sense at all. It's a strange thing. In the Hebrew text, 3 random letters floating around that don't fit. And so I want to share this word of testimony with you. I've been studying this book for a lot of years, and I can remember, and I'm going back to the days before I went into the ministry, I'm going back 30 years ago. I remember studying through with a particular guy who's had some teaching tapes, and I'm studying through this book of Esther and these 10 sons. And I remember him saying something about the 10 sons being hanged. And remember, Haman is a picture of who? The final Antichrist. He is an Antichrist, Haman is. And he has 10 sons who are hanged. And then I remember hearing something about Hitler. and 10 of his accomplices, and I couldn't remember the details. But I was working on this, and on Thursday of this past week, as I'm going through this, I remembered this, and I said, somewhere in my notes, I have something about this. Well, I pulled out, I have a stack of notebooks like this, filled up with pages, and so I started going through, and I got through maybe one or two that I was like, I don't see it yet, but it's there somewhere, I'll find it later. So I went to bed Thursday night. All right, Thursday night, I'm sleeping in the middle of the night. The Lord woke me up, and this is the strangest thing God has ever said to me in the middle of the night. He said, that thing with the 10 sons, I said, yeah. He said, tomorrow morning I want you to Google it. That's what he said to me, tomorrow morning I want you to Google it. Okay, God, got it, I'll Google it. So I went back to sleep. Next morning I got up, I remembered that conversation, the fact that I even remembered it was a miracle. And then I went and I Googled it. So let me tell you what happened. I got up, I Googled it, and I typed in the 10 sons of Haman and 10 of Hitler's henchmen, and immediately this website came up, and I clicked on it. And this was from a rabbi in Stroudsburg, PA, and he laid out the very details that were in my mind from 30 years ago. He laid it all out. I want you to hear this. Let me share with you. I copied a portion of it. This is, by the way, this comes from a rabbi named Baruch Melvin from Stroudsburg, Pennsylvania, Temple Israel. He wrote this in 2010. All right, here it goes. He wrote, at the end of World War II, Hitler's most loyal Nazi henchmen were rounded up and put on trial for crimes against humanity. The Nuremberg trial riveted the world's attention and brought to justice the planners and perpetrators of the most evil the world had ever seen. One by one, each of the 10 men who were sentenced to be hanged took his place under the gallows and said their last words. Then Julius Streicher walked up to the spot under the noose. Julius Streicher shouted his last words, Forumfest 1946, just as he was about to be hanged. What is remarkable, said the rabbi, is that if you look inside the scroll of Esther, in the same section where the 10 sons of Haman were named, after they were hanged, you can find 3 tiny letters embedded in various places within the Hebrew text. These are the letters Ta, She, and Zayin, which when placed together is the name of the Jewish year corresponding to 1946. Indeed, the date of the hanging in October 1946 was just a few weeks, he says, after Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year, Ta, She, Zayin, or 5707 on the Jewish calendar. The Megillah, which is the scroll of Esther, was read from for nearly 2,500 years, but the mystery of those hidden 3 letters only became clear in this last generation. Göring was supposed to be hanged as well, and therefore there would have been 11 hangings. But he committed suicide in his cell the night before. So in the end, exactly 10 men were hanged, corresponding to the 10 names of Haman's sons, as recorded in the Bible's book of Esther. In the story of Esther, Haman met his death, along with his 10 sons, who were his loyal accomplices. Similarly, at the end of World War II, Hitler met his death, along with his 10 most loyal accomplices. Haman was the first in recorded history to attempt genocide against the Jewish people. He nearly succeeded, but failed in the end. Hitler nearly succeeded as well, but similarly failed in the end. And now Iran, which is the birthplace of Haman, which sponsors Hamas and Hezbollah, the premier fomenters of hatred against the Jewish people today, is trying to build nuclear weapons with which to eviscerate Israel. And Iran has publicly stated that as its goal. This will not stand. written by Rabbi Melvin back in 2010. Now, one last thing I want to share with you. The full day of the hanging of these men was October the 16th of 1946. The date that the Lord spoke to me and said, tomorrow morning, Google this. I got up that morning. Guess what the date was on Friday? I'll just tell you, today's the 18th. It was the 74th anniversary of this event. Do you think God can't speak to us right here, right now, about things that are happening? He does. And I marvel at the goodness of God and the faithfulness. Amen? Amen. God is he's on the ball. He's with it, and he knows what to do. And so notice that a second day of killing occurred in Shushan, the citadel, because there were still many more enemies of the Jews who, if this had been let pass, they would have later attacked the Jews. And so Esther asked, please, Your Highness, let there be a second day where the Jews can defend themselves. I think there's going to be more attacks, and sure enough, there were. And those last 300 enemies, are then killed within the capital city. And in total, we're told that 75,000 enemies of the Jews are defeated throughout the kingdom of Xerxes. So all of this to make point number one, the fear of the Jews. Here's point number two. These last two go quick, okay? Point number two. Point number two is the Feast of the Jews. The Feast of the Jews, verses 17 through the end of chapter 9. And so on these 2 days, the Jews defeated their enemies, and Mordecai then called for a time of feasting and celebrating. The Jews not only gave gifts to each other, watch it with me, but they gave food to the poor as well. This is how you know a work has been done in God, when the poor are remembered in this time of celebrating. And I want to just say one more time, the reason God's blessing is on this church is because the poor are remembered in this community and free meals are given to them. God is honoring this church for its faithfulness. I'm just saying. I've never had a church that did what you do. I'm so grateful for your witness. So Mordecai then calls for this celebration of Purim, meaning the casting of lots. And it was to be an annual celebration of the Jews, which would always recall God's faithfulness and what he had done to deliver his people. How many know that it's good that we remember the times when God has helped us? Amen? It's good that we remember. It's good that we look back. We look back on every communion Sunday and we remember the good thing that God did for us. And God made that a lasting covenant for all time, that we would remember always what he did for us. And so Esther then, we're told, followed with a letter establishing the festival of Purim for the generations to follow. And all of this went into the official records of the empire. And here is the third and final point this morning. We had the fear of the Jews, the feast of the Jews, and then chapter 10, the fame of Mordecai. How many like to see good people who do good things get recognized? Don't you thrill to see that? I love to see that. And I have to say, I have been really lifted as I have been watching portions of this confirmation process of Amy Coney Barrett. Amy is a humble and modest servant of the Lord, not to mention a very brilliant scholar. Her adopting of 2 children from Haiti to raise them in a Christian home warmed my heart. And then to see her with a disabled child of her own to care for, in addition to all of the duties that she has in her work. And then this week there was, and I reposted this one on my Facebook page, it was so moving, it was the story of a blind student that was one of Amy's students. Amy was the professor, and this young girl came, and she had lots of special tools, special programs on her computer that helped her read Braille. She's completely blind, so everything is done by reading Braille, and her machine broke down, and it left her completely derailed. She was without any chance of being able to complete her studies. She went to Amy Coney Barrett and told her what happened, and her words to her were, she said, this is not your problem anymore, this is my problem now. And she went to work and she got her new computer, she got her all the tools she needed, This young lady went on to complete her studies and is now a clerk for the court. Lying. It's amazing. What a powerful testimony that was. Listen, I rejoice when good people are recognized for the good they have done. And I'm always grateful for the witness that they give for Christ. And I believe that Amy has truly pointed the way for us on what a surrendered life to the will of God can accomplish. What a marvelous testimony. I don't know how the vote will go. I don't know what's going to happen in this election, but I know what stirred my heart, and that touched my heart. Well, Mordecai has been such a man of God as well. He took responsibility for his niece. He raised her as his own child. He trained her up in the ways of the faith, and he established her. And then when she rose to power, even within a pagan empire, he was there supporting her, guiding her, praying for her, standing with her all the way through. And then notice that when Esther came to her moment, her pivotal moment, she remembered the one who had raised her. She turned around and rewarded her uncle for what he had done for her. And the king then honored Mordecai, and he stepped forward and took his position of authority within the kingdom. Church, I'm going to tell you that there are things that you have done behind the scenes that nobody knows about. There are prayers you have prayed. There are people you have ministered to. There are acts of service. There are things that you have done where you've made sacrifices. Nobody may know about it, but you know about it and God knows about it. All of it gets recorded in His book. And the day is coming when you will be singled out, when you will be called forward, and where you will be rewarded and honored for all the things you have done, things nobody knew about. Persecutions you suffered when people maligned you, when people spoke evil of the good you had done, when they put you down, when you were doing things and it was a great sacrifice on your part, whether it was a financial gift, whether it was a service to someone, whatever it was, God took note of it. It was recorded in His book. And there will come a day when He's going to tell you about things you did that you forgot about long ago. But because you were faithful in that moment to honor God, you will be rewarded, and the rewards will be given out at the judgment seat of Christ, the Bema seat of Christ, kind of like the Olympics when they come and they hang that gold medal on you or that silver or bronze medal. You're going to be brought forward and God is going to honor you, and there are going to be crowns given to those who have been faithful. He sees everything you do and He will reward you openly. What has been done in the darkness is going to be shouted in the light, and people will be honored who have been faithful with the help of God's Holy Spirit. And so I'm telling you this morning that one day we will be rewarded as well. You see, Esther's story is really our story. What has been done in the darkness will be proclaimed in the light. All of our deeds done for Christ will one day be rewarded in His heavenly kingdom, where we too will rule and reign with Him. Church, I believe the best days of the church are ahead of us. Was one that Heidi and I heard a short time ago from a rising star right now, a young lady who is doing a tremendous work. Her name is Candace Owens. And this is what she said. She said, listen, I've read about this. Nobody beats God. Nobody beats God. Amen? God is going to win. His people are going to be with Him. He is going to take us through all of the craziness that's ahead. So you just buckle your seatbelt and hang on. God is steering this ride, and it's going to be okay. Amen. Let's have a prayer together. Father, we're grateful for all this amazing Megillah that you have given us, this incredible story of overcoming faith by these faithful saints who only wanted to be faithful and were clinging to you in the midst of a lot of darkness. Lord, we feel like we're in the same place But we know that you're going to guide us as you guided them. We know you're going to give victory to us as you gave victory to them. We know that you're going to see us through the way you saw them through. We know that we're safe in your hands and that no harm can befall us as long as our eyes are on the King. The worst they can do is kill the body, but they can never touch the soul. So, Lord, thank you for the blessing, the peace, the security, and the hope that you bring to your church this day. We claim it and we walk in it in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Let's stand and sing, please, our closing song. Surrounds you, and he will give.